easier to be the first speaker than last. And I say that because you've been among the giants today. The giants that not only shaped the litigation, not only shaped the lawmaking, not only shaped the overall public discussion, that they were the foundation of everything that made the laws that we have now truly and fundamentally, I think, the envy of the nation. So I wish I could have just said welcome and gotten out of here. And I would never want to even try to measure up to the folks that you got to hear from today. I think that my education of recreational access and the importance of what you've been talking about in many ways came long before I went to law school. That my summer job through college was being a tour boat guide at the Gates of the Mountains. And before that, I was a gas boy. When I was going to then apply for law school, I wrote about, in part, about sort of the church of my youth. I had an older brother who would drag me through where the Beartooth Game Management Area is and others into sort of the backcountry, little creeks and streams. And that's where, in part, I think, was my ground. Never forget, I ended up going to college, a small college outside of Los Angeles, and I'm already getting nervous that if I go too far away, then Michelle's going to gavel me down. So I'm going to go pretty damn quick. But so my last year before my senior year in college, I was outside of LA, and I had this opportunity to like go work at this investment bank or something like that, this great internship that could lead to something wonderful for your future. And I said, I will never have a chance to live along the Missouri River, because it had a little one-room house out at the marina at the Gates of the Mountains. Along the Missouri River, the longest river in North America, stretching 2,700 miles. It's amazing how much stuff I still remember from those days. I can't but so I chose for that to be my place, because it was a place of grounding. And fast forward a handful of years, I show up at the Attorney General's office under Joe Mazurek in a cubicle. The only way I finally got that office is because my voice was so loud that everybody's like, we gotta get Bullock out of here, because he's just bothering people. But he provided me two incredible opportunities that I didn't even know would have a chance to both impact what the history of this discussion is, but also impact my political life in many ways. And first was, there was a fairly contentious issue along the Ruby River. Imagine it's not the first time you've heard that today. But it had to do with recreational access from streams, or two streams from highways, bridges, and abutments. And they had asked for an attorney general opinion, which has to force the law until the court says otherwise. And Bob Lake, you probably remember as well or better than anyone, but my time both working in the attorney general's office and serving as attorney general, never had an AG opinion garnered that much comment and concern. And I was just a few years out of law school, and Missouri says, all right, well, look, you figured it out. And I don't remember what all Bob, because for an AG opinion, first you write a draft. I don't remember what all was in that, but as dug in, it seemed like we had these incredible rights and a right of way in all of our streams. And it's just where two right of ways cross. And you ought to be able to take advantage of the full easement. That was one of the finding moments. And another one was, I don't know if you guys talked about Madison versus Graham. It was when a guy, James Watt, Willing Perry Penley of Mountain States Legal Foundation, decided to sue to get rid of all the good work that had been done before on a substantive due process claim. And when it comes to recreational access. And I'll never forget, I got to go to federal court. I was representing all of us. I'm like, my name's Steve Bullock. I represent the people of Montana, and these rivers and streams belong to all of us. Now, don't PolitiFact check that. I don't quite remember what the transcript was. But what I do remember is, like, this is the coolest job in the world. this is the most amazing job in the world. So shortly thereafter, I ran for Attorney General, and I don't think my whole family voted for me. Because I don't know if you've heard of me, he's now the Chief Justice, Mike McGrath. But yeah, in 2000, I ran in part because I was inspired by, look at what I got to do, something that tied for my youth. And going among the rivers and the streams to standing in court, not just representing a client, but representing all the people of Montana for something that is a bedrock importance to so many of us that live here. I was asked to speak in part about the role that Stream Access played in my last campaign for governor. I don't know whose idea that was, but. Okay, before I even get to that, I'd say though that maybe perhaps more importantly, the role that Stream Access played in everyone's campaigns. Because when I ran for Attorney General successfully 8 years later, there were ads about Stream Access. And a lot of my talk was about Stream Access. When I first ran for governor in 2012, the same both what we had accomplished and what we, as Attorney General, and what we could look forward to. And then in 2016, both that on the positive side and on the little bit more challenging side when my opponent sued in recreational access near his home. But I underscore that because I'll never forget when I first was run for Attorney General, I wanted to talk about Stream Access, and in part, it was because campaigns reflect the values that you hold, right? But in part, I fundamentally believed that it was an important issue. And the pollster said, you want to talk about what? You want to talk about people all being able to get into streams and rivers? I said, yeah. And it resonated, though. And it resonated in ways, and it resonates to Montanans, no matter where we are, who, where we come from. It resonates in a way that I think transcends sort of the contemporary political divides so many times. And I think in part it's because it's one of those things that I call that great equalizer. That it doesn't matter how wealthy we are, what land we own. It doesn't matter what family we were in. We all have an opportunity to access that. And then we all have the opportunity, that same fifth grader that I learned about Kentucky at his state presentation this morning, was like, Dad, can we go maybe ice fishing this weekend? If any of you are good ice fishermen, I have an 11-year-old who would love to go. But it's something that is generational. And it's as a public or a great equalizer, it's generation. And I have no doubt that you've heard, and I think back to my Attorney General days, I have no doubt that you've heard at times about some of the contention and the divides that have occurred when it comes to stream access. But I also think about the coalitions that were built in 2009 when we took what was deemed as a controversial AG opinion that made a hell of a lot of sense to me about access from bridges and abutments, and then somehow got a pass through legislature in a way that landowners and recreationists could say, yeah, this is important, and this is part of what Montana is, and we've just got to make sure that we can ensure to find the ways to make it all work together. One of the other things, when I was Attorney General, and I don't know if it was discussed here, but you have to give both many of the lawyers and others, the PLWA folks, so much credit for fighting along the way where there weren't always other areas or other groups or other state entities that were stepping up in the way that they were. And can think of two different areas where one was Scenic Road in Terry, Montana, and then the other was Tenderfoot Creek, kind of near the Smith River, where during that period of time, so that's 2008 to 2012, seems like, at least from my perspective, we're seeing more and more gates on roads. And near Terry, one came up and I, of course, said, "Hi, Steve, I'm the Attorney General. I'm here to help you." And while as I can look at the 2009 legislation dealing with recreational access that transcended partisanship, don't kid yourself, when somebody from Helena comes to Eastern Montana and says, "I'm here to help you," there's still a little bit of challenge. Like, county commissioners feel, "I don't need your help. I don't want your help. We need to figure out a way to deal with this." But in the, I think it was the Tenderfoot case, we did exercise more or less the independent authorities that the Attorney General has to get involved in that litigation. And it's something that, as we go forward in this, that I think, and I haven't logged on to Lexis lately, but that there's good language in there about sort of the ability for an AG to uphold that public trust doctrine and get involved when it comes to access in places that maybe sometimes either a local county attorney or others don't want to. Last campaign certainly did have some discussions about stream access, but more than that, too, is about public lands and the threats that we have in many respects to access to public lands. I talked quite a bit about, and we've formed in the DNRC a public land specialist. The idea is that both to work with landowners, we know that we have about 2 million acres of lands that are landlocked, there is no access to. But to work with landowners to try to negotiate ways to get easements or other things. And also, ideally, if that's all you can do, is to sue to take what were traditionally public areas, access lands, and reopen them up as we go forward. Talked a lot about Habitat Montana, which is a program that's paid for by sportsman's dollars to acquire access and acquire land for all of us to use. And for a while, our legislature said, no, even though it's sports, recreational dollars, that we shouldn't be in the business of buying any more land. One finite thing that we know for sure. And also then forming an Office of Outdoor Recreation. The professor had some slides, but at the base level, I always say, you know, we're a state of 1 million people and we have 12 million people that visit us and they're coming for our Walmarts. They're coming for these incredible experiences that we can have in the outdoors. And our stream access laws are fundamentally part of that, and our public lands are part of that. Even more than maybe running on recreational access, stream access, though, is like the terror that I felt in some ways when I had to make a decision to close the Yellowstone River right in the middle of the campaign. Our rivers are heating up. Things are changing. And the idea, kind of at the heart of what is the economic driver in Livingston, to say, all right, we're having fish kills. No more people on the river. But what was amazing to me in so many ways was how guides, how local communities, how others said, this resource is so important to us long term that even if this ruins my year, ruins my season, if that's what science says, we better do it. And how what could have divided communities brought them together. It reminds me that when I was running for governor, I learned that there's two ways to become a scientist, wildlife biologist. One's to come here and get a master's, and the other is to run for office. You know, so But the moments where then we can sort of step back and say, these resources are so important that let's actually listen to the scientists, I think are so important for all of us. I think one of the reasons why to be here though today for all of you, don't worry Michelle, just about to wrap up, isn't just to be among the giants that have preceded me, but and it's not just to be nostalgic about the history of what's happened in Montana, but it's to remember that we need to both understand and completely absorb the history, because if not, it will quickly repeat itself. And I'd love to turn around and say that the threats to stream access and the threats to our public lands aren't real. They're just used to further divide people in politics, but I don't think that's the case at all. I think back to American Lands Council, which is a legislator from Utah that's talking about the transfer to federal lands. And his first, when he was, well, he was pitching all throughout the West, and his video that he used had a lot of me speaking as a governor, like saying, talking about fires and what we ought to be doing better. But it's a reminder that, yeah, we can always do better and work with and sometimes work against our federal partners. But the idea that, the simplistic idea that we're just going to transfer these lands to the state and somehow life will be great is absurd, because at the end of the day, those lands would leave our state hands and be privatized. This last year is a perfect example, right? Most expensive fire season we've ever had. $72 million the state of Montana spent. Feds north of $400 million. The threat is real. It's in both, not to get partisan, National Republican Party platform and the state party platform has been, we need to transfer these lands. And transferring those lands is the first step ultimately towards selling them off. And the threat is real, I think, because as I said, one of the most finite assets that we have in Montana, and Montana's becoming, I think, much better known than since many of us were kids, is the land and the landscapes and the access and the beauty to these streams and rivers. And where great amount of money meet beautiful places, all of us, the public, could lose out. So notwithstanding the fact that there's a national group trying to transfer lands, notwithstanding the fact that it's in political party platforms, also, won't forget, like a year ago, I think it was a year ago, where there was a rally during the legislative session about public lands in Montana. And 1,300 people at least showed up. These aren't folks that are engaged every day in the political system. These aren't just fly fisher people, bait fishers, not just hikers, they're four wheelers. And it underscores that, to me, seeing this big group of folks, who it's always fun to go to a lot of things like this when people say, hey, great meeting you. You know, I didn't vote for you. Yeah, I know that. That's okay, because here is a unifying force. But so great seeing all those folks saying, these lands belong to me. And that was about the time that Chaffetz and others had a federal bill trying to transfer. And I'm not quite sure, but I think even all the way to Washington, D.C., they heard the voice of everyday Montanans coming up and saying, we're not going to transfer these, not on our watch. I think that serves as a reminder, not unlike some of the lawyers that have helped out over time and not gotten paid what they should have, or the folks that sat around tables or went into county courthouses to do a little bit of research on where these established roads, backstop points that at the end of the day, the power of maintaining one of these great equalizers still doesn't rest with the powers of wealth or the powers of government. It fundamentally